Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this review of the Owen HTS272S mini oscilloscope signal generator and multimeter. Now I must just qualify, you get various models which some will omit the signal generator, but it's certainly a little Swiss Army knife. Thanks to Owen for putting this into my hands. I know a fair time back they notified me that they're developing this, and it's taken a little bit of time to get it out. And then I've also been away on vacation, so it's taken a bit of time to get the review out. However, I must say, I'm fairly impressed with this little device. They cost anywhere from around, I'm seeing on eBay, from around $150 for the entry-level model. But I've seen this one, which is the top one at 70 megahertz with a signal generator, two-channel, 20,000 count multimeter for around $270-odd. I can certainly see this fitting a lot of folks who are just starting to get into the hobby and would like an all-in-one unit. It's always nicer to have separate items, a separate scope, multimeter, and let's say signal generator, but I can certainly see the benefits to this, and this fits quite a few use cases for me. One in particular is my high accuracy clock project, where I'm sitting at my desk working at a computer, USB into Arduino, and I'm having to generate a clock signal and look at a signal coming out from the Arduino. And I've had a separate portable generator. I used to have to lug an oscilloscope there. I eventually went and got a portable oscilloscope, and I particularly had to find one which had a good update speed, because capturing a clock pulse only happening every second can be a challenge. And this device actually does that. Now, it's not without its faults. We're going to take it to the bench, and I'll show you where I think certainly some improvements can be made. But all in all, so far, I have been relatively impressed by this device. But anyway, let's get down to the bench. Right then, so normally if I'm filming on my bench, the one thing I want to try and avoid is light reflecting on the screen, because obviously that's annoying. But I do want to show you that after I peeled off the protective cover or piece of paper that was on the screen, you can see there is a fair amount of reflection on the screen. And I would say that this would be susceptible to scratching and micro scratches. And I'm going to say something very unusual. It's the first time I would ever have said this, because I hate having those plastic screen protectors on my multimeters and what have you. But I'd say in this case, if you want to have a more matte display and a little bit of protection, you actually might want to leave that protective film on there. I've seen other reviews where obviously they haven't removed it because it doesn't really affect the display that much. If, like me, you're going to remove it, I'd actually recommend going on Amazon and trying to find one of those screen protectors, one of those kind of hardened glass protectors which just covers this area, and that may help. I know my other scope, the Mitsic, actually comes with a screen protector which adds a bit of matte finish, so it doesn't reflect as much. But nonetheless, I want to show you that the display on this has got quite a high contrast, bright display once you get the settings right. So even with reflections, you can see nice, bright, and high contrast, even with the reflective screen. But anyway, we'll take a closer look at that. So physically, it comes in a nice little package. It does have some cheaper plastics on it, but it does have rubberized protection where it counts. So when you've got it down on surfaces, it comes into contact with the rubber casing. That is also true if you lie flat on its face. If you see, if I just turn it to the camera like that, you can see that if it's flat on its face, basically everything is protected, the buttons and the screen. However, as I said, some of these plastics are a little chintzy. The stand, for instance, you can hear it's got a little click point to keep it open, and it almost feels like you're going to break it when you get there. So these aspects of the build, not so great, but I don't think they take away from what this device can offer someone. The other advantage is that it is powered by 18650s. I'll open up the back now so you can have a look. It comes with a charger and a USB Type-C, And in this port over here, you've got your USB Type-C, and then you've got a test signal here for checking the compensation on the probe that it comes with. Let's just take a quick look at what it does come with. You do get a nice case where all the cables and the device fit nice and snugly into. You get a nice quality, fairly thick USB Type-C charge cable. There is software as well. Now, I haven't evaluated the software. That I might do in another video, but it does come with software. You obviously get the USB charger as well. 2-amp. This is a 5-volt 2-amp power adapter. It comes with one probe. Now, bear in mind that this is a two-channel device. So as you can see, you've got the channel 1, channel 2, and then if you get the S option, that's the signal generator, then you've also got the third output or third BNC over here. It comes with a set of crocodile clips, so you can clip onto a circuit and either inject a signal or read a signal through these. You've got another set of crocodile clips which you can use for the multimeter inputs. And then you also have a set of test leads. Not the greatest quality, but also not the worst I've seen. They do come, the actual leads on silicone, but they do feel like nice quality leads. These are the connectors, the banana connectors that go into the multimeter. They do have these little plastic bits on them to protect the length of the test probe. If you are working in situations where you're worried about a short, or let's say a cabinet with high energy, and you want to try and avoid touching things that you don't want, then you can have these little nubs on just so that you've got the tips exposed and the points are nice and fairly sharp. We'll test these in a continuity test to see how well they work at, let's say, testing an IC. The 70 megahertz probe that does come with it is a times 1 and a times 10. Again, not the highest quality, but it'll do the job. Obviously, it comes with a little booklet with a little screwdriver for doing the compensation and rings if you want to change the color coding, and then a manual. So what I'll do, I'll just quickly highlight the specifications and you can pause the video if you want to take a closer look at those. Right, I'll highlight some specifications that catch my eye. These are the specs related to the oscilloscope. You've got the 40 megahertz and the 70 megahertz models noted here. Two channel, the real-time sampling rate. So you can see when you're in dual channel, it drops to 125 megasamples per second, or single channel, you've got 250 megasamples per second. Now, your sample rate will also change depending on the memory setting. This has 8K of memory. You can set that to 4K. If you set it to the higher memory setting, you are going to get a higher sample rate. But potentially what you risk doing is then slowing down the update speed or the refresh rate. Now, this quotes at 10,000 waveforms per second. Now, we're going to test that, and I say so far I've been impressed, because often these small portable oscilloscopes, you can have a quoted sample rate, but the actual update rate, because it has to capture and digitize a sample, process that, and then display it on the screen. And that procedure of the processing and then sending an update to the screen is where the oscilloscope has dead time, and that's where you can miss, in particular, infrequent signals or pulses. And in that regard, I'm fairly critical of scopes, because that's generally what I work with, is clock pulses. And this seems to do well, but we'll have a closer look at that. So you can see the other specifications on that page. Again, I'm not going to go through these in detail. You can freeze the video and have a closer look. These are the specifications for the multimeter. So if you want to know the accuracies for the various voltage, AC, DC, current, and resistance, we will have a look at some of those. The one key thing to note, obviously, is that it is a 20,000 count, which again, for a little package like this, many of these devices where they do like a 3-in-1, a little Swiss Army knife, you might get a maybe 6,000 count or a 10,000 count. And I find it really useful that you can at least go up to, let's say, 20 volts and go down to a millivolt reading, which is quite handy. These are the specifications for the capacitance, the diode test, and what have you. It then talks about the waveform generator. We're going to have a look at this. You can see it's got a nice selection of test waveforms. It goes up to 25 megahertz.
The square wave at notes, it goes up to 5 megahertz. But I will have a closer look at that. It's always a challenge with a square wave because you need a fair bit of bandwidth. And I'd say realistically, that's more like 1 megahertz. But we'll look at that when we get closer into the testing. We've then got the general specifications. Next, let's just quickly open up the back so we can see the battery enclosure. Right, and I'll just do this on camera so you can see the process. As I said, that plastic snap is not the most comforting. This screw does go into a metal receiver, which is nice to see. It's a little bit fiddly, this top, but it does come out. And there are your two 18650s. So that is nice to see. You've got cells which are replaceable and rechargeable, which is really nice. You can see the metal receiver over there. It does have a little bit of an edging around here, but there's certainly no environmental rating in terms of an IP rating. I do know from seeing another video that the screws that hold it together are self-tappers into plastic, not metal, at this price point, probably to be expected. And I say, once I get time, I'll perhaps do a separate video where we open this up and have a look inside. Right, so the next important thing I just wanted to note about this device is, as noted, you can plug in your USB-C. I've got it connected at the moment to that little power adapter, which obviously goes to a main supply. You can see the little power light over here goes red when it's charging. And the one important thing I wanted to note, so having a device like this, whether you're starting out or for like me, is having a portable battery operated oscilloscope can be really handy if you potentially want to avoid issues when you're working on power supplies being grounded and putting your probe in the wrong place and causing a dead short, which can be very dangerous. Or for me, when I was working at my desk with Arduino, the Arduino was powered from USB because I was updating software, making changes, and then I need to do measurements. But by having the Arduino grounded and then an oscilloscope that was connected to mains power, I had a common earth or ground there, and that would cause issues. And that's where, again, a portable oscilloscope can be handy. So what I want to just highlight is that when you do have it connected and charging, just be mindful that potentially, particularly if you have it connected to a PC, you're going to be grounded to your earth's main supply. Now, also, although you've got little plastic shrouding around the BNCs, these BNCs are not isolated from each other, which would be normal for a scope at this price point. If I pull the USB cable out and I go to the main ground plate, I just want to demonstrate that basically, if you have a grounding, which typically happens when you stick this into a PC, your PC is then connected to earth mains, you will be grounding your BNC. So just be aware of that. If you are doing any measurements where you are concerned about grounding because of either danger or upsetting readings, then certainly don't have the USB charge cable connected and just use it as a battery operated device. Right, so we're going to start off by just looking at the resolution and the accuracy of the device. Some of the UI and navigation, particularly once we get to the oscilloscope, I find a little challenging, but obviously it is very difficult to provide an expansive array of buttons or what have you to perform all the functionality that this does within the form factor. Nonetheless, so I've got it set to a normal voltage. You can see here at the top left-hand corner, it'll show you that we are measuring DC volts. We're on auto range. It gives you the range that we're in. We've got the various soft buttons here, F1, 2, 3, 4, where you can go and change functionality denoted on the bottom of the screen over here. Your mode button, just before we get into the testing, will switch between your signal generator and your oscilloscope. Back to your multimeter. For this test, what I'm going to do, you can go select a manual range. We're going to talk about that because I think there's an improvement to be made there. We're going to go from volts to millivolts just to look at the resolution of this device. And you can see we're certainly in the area where there's going to be we potentially in the noise floor of the device or of in the cables that I'm using. It does have a delta button so that we can zero out what was happening on the display, which is very handy. If I then go up and change at this resolution, and certainly here we are in the area where several digits out here is going to be within the accuracy figures of this device. But it's nice to see that down at this level that we've got this resolution and that it certainly is able to track the changes that I'm doing. Now we're going to go and have a look at the higher voltage settings, and I'll highlight the first little niggle or nitpick that I have with this device. So first of all, let's just go and have put 1 millivolt on there. Now, can you see what happened there? It didn't go straight to 1 millivolt. It kind of builds up, ramps up to it. And I had a Siglent benchtop multimeter, which did the same behavior. And it's just something to be aware of, because if you are working with, let's say working on an electronic circuit, an op amp or something, that presentation could indicate that perhaps you've got a voltage building up, let's say from an output of some IC or something like that, when in reality, this is just taking time to ramp up to the reading. I wish they'd almost hold off, like have dashes on the screen until they get to the reading and not display it unless it is a varying voltage. But nonetheless, 1 millivolt, you can see it does okay. We go to the next digit. Again, that build. Go to a tenth of a volt. Slightly out there, but again, in terms of its accuracy rating, it's well within the specification. Right. 1 volt. Again, see how it builds. It's going to change range. And what I want you to note there is that it shows 0 volts as it changes range from 2 volts to 20 volts. So let me just come back down, still in the 20 volt range. And what a meter should do here is, again, perhaps show dashes that you're not seeing a 0 volt reading when it's doing a range change. So here we go, show 0 volts until it builds and gets to the reading. So I'll just step up to the limit of this, which is 10 volts. And at 10 volts, you can see it's slightly out, but again, nothing to complain about. I say, my major issue with this is the ramping up. And what I'll do, I'm just gonna put it next to another meter so you can see as a comparison. Right, and some aspects of what I'm gonna try to show you are gonna be perhaps difficult to perceive because I'm making adjustments on a power supply and you cannot see where I'm adjusting. But I've got 3 meters. The HP bench meter has got a nice fast update speed. Now we can check against how perhaps I think it should behave in comparison to another multimeter. I want you to note again that although the screen is very reflective because of the high contrast and brightness, it still works very well, even though you can see reflections in it. Now, as I turn this up, the thing I want you to look out for on this multimeter when it changes range, for one, this has got a very nice fast update speed, it has to be said. I really like the speed of the update on this meter. It's just that this behavior of it ramping up to a reading and then when it does a range change. So look what happens on the Sanwar. When it does a range change, the screen blanks, you get lines going across, and then it brings up a reading. As opposed to the Owen, which stops, goes to zero, and then flicks to the next range. I wish they would blank the screen and not show you a zero reading, because in certain situations, that could mislead you to either that your circuit's got a fault, you've got a disconnection happening, or momentarily show you a zero reading when perhaps you've got a high voltage, and that could also be dangerous. So I think in software they could change that. Now what I'll do, I'll just take it up to ride it through to the 30 volt range of my power supply just so we can see how it behaves. As you can see, it updates very quickly, range change, and then off it goes to beyond 30 volts. I'm going to switch it off and then switch it on just to see if it overreads. You can see it takes its time, it finds a range, and then it displays. It doesn't seem to be overshooting, it's just that time in working out what range it needs to be and then displaying. What I'll do, I'm going to put it in manual, so we're in the 200 volt range, and then switch it off and then switch it back on. Does that help? Because it's not dealing with working out the range, it does get there quicker, but you can see the ramp up. You can see it's displaying low voltage values occasionally as it ramps up to that reading. I find that it's almost like there's a capacitor there. Once I've done it a few times, there's less ramping. Right, I've gone and switched off some of the lights in the background, and again, it just goes to highlight how nice and bright and high contrast the screen is. Just another test on the voltage. As you can see, a 5 volt reference, no issue there. Next, we'll change it to an AC source. It should be reading 4.999, so it is a little bit out on the AC voltage reading, but the AC voltage specifications will be different. Next, we'll do current. You can see when I switch over to current, it does give you a warning to actually change over the leads, which is nice, and it tells you to push F2. So I go to F2. I've set it to AC. And I noted here, this should be reading just over 1 milliamp. And perhaps I'll pop on the screen the specifications, but this is certainly reading lower on the AC current reading. Next, we'll go to DC. The reference is 0.99, so this is just bouncing one digit outside of that. So for the DC current, not a problem. The AC current seems to be a little bit off. Next, we'll do resistance. For that, we go to F4, and you can see you've got the ohm figure, the continuity, diode, or capacitor. So what I'm just looking at is the resistance. These leads are very short. It's flicking around a little bit, but I'll delta that out. If I go to the 100 ohm, again, it's just that ramping behavior as it's I don't know what's causing it, but it just seems to ramp up and down before it gets to reading. And when we get to the capacitor readings, you'll see that potentially exaggerated. There should be 100.05, so it is a little bit out, but again, not far off in terms of specification. 1K, you can see the range was looking up, and this should be 1.0004, so certainly only very slightly out on the 1K reading. 10K should be 10.001, so only a smidgen out there. 100 should be 100.1, so again, not too far out on the resistor readings. So next, let's look at capacitors. Right, so multimeters aren't the best for reading really small value capacitors that this decade box can go down to. The tolerance on these isn't that tight, but just to show you, so this is a dedicated LCR meter, still not the best or highest accuracy. We're getting 123 picofarad for the 100 picofarad on here. If I transfer over to the Owen, you can see it's reading 142. But as I say, multimeters for those smaller readings aren't the best. If I take that out and let's go to 4 micro. Again, you can see a little bit of a ramp up there. You can see it's got a reading. And I say within the accuracy of this and the tolerance on these capacitors, no complaints. At least once we get into the microfarads, you're going to get relatively good readings. And it is showing just over 2 micro there. Let's go to 1 micro and not far off. Now let's look at the larger values. Right, so the next test on this little device, I've got switched in 2000 microfarad. And I'm going to go straight in. And as you can see, it is sitting and waiting. And I'll do this on another multimeter just to demonstrate the different behavior. So there you go, it's gone right, and now I'm going to add another 1,000. And what I wanted to demonstrate again, the kind of ramping up. It sits, hesitates, sits and works it out, and then ramps up. I'll add another 1,000 there. It's got to quite quickly. What I've noted on this is when I've done a reading, so like right now I've got the 4,000. If I take that out, there's obviously a charge built up potentially in the capacitors here. And then if I go and do a measurement, sometimes it happens relatively quickly, but you can see it's sitting and thinking, waiting, waiting, not displaying anything. It's like perhaps I've got a connection issue. I actually had two switches down there for 2 millifarad, and you can see it takes its time before it gets the reading. Take another multimeter, and now when I add, let's say, 2,000 microfarad, you can see it goes all the dashes while it's calculating or getting there, and then pops up the reading. It pops up the reading. You can see it actually did do a little bit of ramping up there. I'll go to 3,000, and that's come up fairly quickly. So perhaps I'm being a bit picky on this device, but I say, particularly on the voltage reading, and I've noted even off camera when I've done capacitance readings, it doesn't actually show you that it's thinking about it. It shows this zero value when perhaps they should just put some lines through to show that it's actually doing, trying to work it out. And then sometimes I've seen it do quite a fair ramp before it gets to the final reading. And I wish that could be corrected. Right, and for this test, I've just switched the lights off my bench so you can see the LEDs. This is the diode test. So again, on function 4, you go to diode test. You can quite clearly see it can light these LEDs. So we can see the forward drop on the red LED, just over 1.6. We go to the green, it lights that up nicely, 1.8. We go to the blue, it's got enough power or enough voltage to light that up, but no reading. So the interesting thing here, the specification does say less than 2 volts. It's a pity. It's obviously got the voltage output. I think I measured just over 3 volts output with another multimeter. It's just a pity it doesn't do readings at that level. But nonetheless, anything less than 2 volts, it's able to do. Right, so lastly on the multimeter, the continuity tester. It does appear to be latched, so at least the continuity tester, you don't get any of that scratchiness. It actually latches and does the beep. In terms of speed, it's a little bit slow, but just as a practical demonstration, let's say I was trying to trace where, let's say, a point on a circuit. I'm just on a pot over here, and I sweep the legs of this IC over here. So you can see, as long as I'm not in a mad rush, it's still fast enough to actually do continuity and pick up, let's say, try and trace something that's going to an IC on a board.